inclusive economy?
For us and a lot of other people, an inclusive economy is a space that's created that is targeted, that allows for the cultivation of others to come up, allows for kind of that hand up or that arm up type of outreach that says, we see you, and because we see you, we want to create a space that's inclusive of you as well. An inclusive economy focuses on jobs, it focuses on opportunity, it focuses on resources, and it reaches not only these places that look very attractive, but the places in our community that that are created to gather people around.
To people who would say, why should we spend my taxpayer money, you know, my Measure U money and my sales tax money, public dollars toward an inclusive economy? You know, I don't live in those neighborhoods, or my kids wouldn't benefit from the Simmons Center. We live in Natomas. What would you say to clue someone in about why it's important for everybody in our community?
Right, so I voted for Measure U. I advocated for Measure U. This is the second time I voted for Measure U. This time around, I voted for it because of the huge effort to be inclusive in cultivating local economies that are helping to fund grassroots organizations in all of the districts, not only in District 8, and Larry Carr has been a huge champion for our particular space and the work here in South Sacramento, but in every one of the districts, there are opportunities to be inclusive. There are opportunities to create a space of opportunity. There are opportunities to cultivate jobs. There are opportunities to cultivate youth activities in every one of our districts. That's what inclusive economic development looks like. It's creating that pipeline of opportunities in all different sectors, whether in the health equity sector, whether in the job sector, whether in the fun, cool kind of pop-up events that really create that safe space for young folks together, families to be cultivated, and families to together as well.
Spell it out for me. I mean, in no uncertain terms, you know, there are neighborhoods in Sacramento that have historically been left behind, have been underserved. Is this an opportunity to help those communities who have been underserved?
Just an opportunity to help every one of the communities, not only those that historically have gotten their fair share, but also those communities that historically have been left out, like you've mentioned, to be inclusive of them, to create opportunities, to create resources, and to kind of seed and cultivate the next generation of greatness to come out of every part of Sacramento, right? Simmons Center is a reflection of that. Simmons Center is that idea, along with other kind of grassroots community organizing and organizations that's happening around Sacramento. But this for us is that one of those opportunities that says, let's create a space that's inclusive enough, targeted enough to bring everybody up.
So that's a good transition to talk about, you know, the Simmons Center and what your, again, piece of the puzzle is in this inclusive economy. We're sitting here. Give us introduce us to the Simmons Center. What do you do here? What has it historically meant to this community? And what do you see for its future?
Right. The Simmons Center has been here. Well, this was historically Calscape. It's been that for 40 plus years. It's a place of community gathering, a place of fun memories. People would come and skate here. Somebody said, man, I lived here as a kid. And then the investment into revitalizing this was not there. And so some years ago, our church and other partners got together and we were able to acquire this facility a few years back. And since then, this now has become that community hub, that community gathering spot. Once again, that it was for my generation, it will be that for generations to come. Now, it's been because of where we are today is because of the shared partnership with public and private entities, entities like the City of Sacramento that has said, we want to partner in inclusive economic development and help bring resources to support the program work that happens here. It's been that because of the Kings. As you see, the new floor we have, a brand new NBA floor. Well, the Kings, one of their NBA floors, a fan favorite, it was delivered here, installed here by the Kings. That's targeted partnership by the Kings. Some SMUD and Sierra Health Foundation have been a huge partner in kind of the philanthropic work that happens around what partnerships look like here. What goes on? Basketball, skating, family gatherings, kind of those pop-up events that we are hearing about, that happens here. It'll be jobs here for young folks to have, jobs for families to have, health and educational workshops, alternative to violence workshops, workshops on SAT and ACT, the prep for college that'll happen here, and STEM will happen here. All kind of things that just come into a community that allows for growth, allows for opportunity, allows a person to dream. Can you imagine a kid playing on that NBA floor that is 12 and 15 years old, like with our King and Queens Rise basketball program, playing on this floor that Chris Webber used to play on? Next thing you know, they're taking basketball shots, making three-pointers, saying, I could do that. I could be that next great person. Imagine the 2K gaming that goes on that now is a huge opportunity, that because we're leaning all the way into STEM and having that partnership with kind of the tech world to create that space. Imagine the just knowledge base that's gonna come right from here through some of those partnerships.
I mean, talk to me about the Simmons Center, the Simmons Community Center's role in job creation, and what, you know, can you talk numbers, can you talk timeline?
Right. So a lot of those jobs are happening now with some of the opportunities we have with our summer STEM program, which we are bringing on 100, we'll have capacity for 150 kids. Alongside of that are those youth mentors that will come in and mentor them in STEM, science, technology, engineering, and math. More jobs will come from kind of the pop-up events and planning those events that will go out to our youth and kids that are coming home from college that need that opportunity. Those happen right here, and they happen within our organization as well. This serves as that, as well as creating space for kind of our cultural brokers, and you've heard us talk about that with our Black Child Legacy campaign. Those are jobs and places in which a person works right here and connects to the community in a way that brings them resources, brings them opportunity, brings them support in areas that are needed. So we have it'll be a snack bar here. It'll be kind of monitors around the courts, monitors around the skating area. Those are all opportunities and jobs for that whole inclusive economic piece and creating kind of those opportunities for young folks and individuals within this community to have that kind of job.
Ballpark, how many jobs would you say will come out of all of sort of the you know, this is the hub, like the spokes, you know, that are coming off of the Simmons Center, you know, between the, you know, attendance here and the snack bar and some of the other programs that you mentioned. You know, how many jobs would you say that could be?
You know, I don't have an exact number, but I think it's a pretty good number that we are targeting to make sure that we have space to be able to create opportunity for young folks here and for individuals seeking employment. We, in addition to that, we do partner with SETA and run our job recruitment and training agency as well to help just a person fill out their resume and create those opportunities that are out there in the community for jobs. But to answer the question directly, I think we're still figuring some of exactly how many jobs will be cultivated, exactly how many kind of stipend-based employment opportunities will, but I would imagine it's going to be a good number of young folks that will be working through these doors and have some opportunity for resources as a result of our partnerships.
You know, for people who say, you know, okay, great, Mayor Steinberg's allocating $40 million over the course of the next 5 years, you know, to fund this, you know, various economic or inclusive economy projects, how will this continue on in the future beyond 5 years, you know, to impact not just kids who are maybe in high school now, but their little brothers and sisters and 10 years from now, 15 years?
Right. I think some of it is still being determined what past 5 years looks like. But there has to be some commitment to stimulate what needs to happen in order to even get to a place of having opportunity places, having this whole targeted inclusive economic piece happening. There has to be some real focus, which, you know, we're grateful for the mayor, as well as the most of the council have definitely leaned in and supported this in a way that it is passing, right? It's passed. And so now, I think right now is really that time where all of these kind of creative ideas to create a space that allows for growth, that allows for opportunity, that allows for the job creation and workforce readiness, and just a person to dream and have hope and say, man, I went to the Simmons Center, I went to the La Familia Center, I went to Del Paso, and there was these grassroots community places that not only were a hub for community gatherings, for a safe space and a cool kind of sport and things to do, but I found a career there. I got employment there, and I had a dream there. That's what this whole inclusive economic development piece is. It's creating that hope for the next generation, right? Right down on a grassroots level, on a community-based level. That's what that is. I think it's a very righteous thing that the mayor, the city council, and those that elected to pass both Measure U and then to pass the whole economic community, target economic development piece as well.
Is there anything you would say to people who say, how can you prove that this money will be worth it? Or sure, it might be worth it, but is it worth more than adding on a few other firefighters or police officers, you mm-hmm. know? What's your take on that?
Well, a couple of things. It's not one or the other. It's creating the space for all, right? So it's not just focusing in on one thing. It's focusing in on all things, as well as making sure that there is equity in there, that when there was not focus on certain areas, now there's extra attention. That's why inclusive economic development is important. That's the whole equity piece of creating a space where all boats can float. Now, I'd say, how do you measure hope? You measure hope by morale. You measure hope by when a kid comes through one of these grassroots organizations' doors and they see opportunity, they are joyful, they are happy. And you could look at that and say, man, we just created a space that is for community, by community, and gonna create just these happy moments. That's how you measure kind of the hope of a thing. And then I say the data is gonna come when you look at start to look at crime starting to come down. When you look at employment and the kind of measure of income bracket within a community coming up, right? I think that's going to come as we approach kind of or get into the years and the implementation of Measure U funds and the grassroots organizations.
And that takes time. That's not an overnight switch.
It's not an overnight thing. It takes time, but it does take targeted investment. And that's what this is, and that's what it should be, targeted investment. A lot of these organizations, including the entities within the city, have been operating, you know, with little to no resources and doing some amazing work, right? Now imagine the partnership with public and private entities in a way that is intentional, in a way that is focused. I think we're gonna see some major things happen in our city. For instance, the pop-up events were created at a moment of crisis. And in those moments of crisis, the community organizations that came together and partnered first with like a philanthropic partner, Sierra Health Foundation, and created these pop-up events, you saw an instant solve of some tension and some moments within our city. Not that they solved it themselves, but they created space for young folks to solve it. And now it's opportunity to continually do that, right? I think you're gonna see the impact of that by putting the resources and the opportunities with the young folks and then allowing them to be a part of the change. I think doing that now with creating jobs, creating economic development, putting it within the community, within these targeted areas in South Sac, targeted areas in Oak Park, Del Paso, targeted areas all over Sacramento, and saying we're gonna target these areas with some opportunity and some resources, and we're gonna kind of cultivate a dream, cultivate opportunity, cultivate creativity.
The money is gonna go to people who already have boots on the ground, who say, I have relationships with people in these communities. We already have programs going. You're just adding more lifeblood to these already successful programs that, like you said, have been able to operate on little to no money in the past. How much more so will an influx of capital help the good work you're already in progress of doing?
That's definitely gonna lift all boats. It's gonna create future opportunity to open space up for more people. And continue to just cultivate the good things that are happening in all of our communities. And as I said before, and you mind you, I'm partly a pastor, preacher too, so I can get to talking and keep on talking, so interrupt me at any time. But I feel like there is a real sense of, from the community, a sense of we are all in this together. Because of the efforts of Measure U, the mayor and the city council voting to put resources down in grassroots areas, in addition to all of the other stuff that's being funded. There are many other things that's being funded. The fire department's getting a lot of practically everything that was in the budget for them, right? There are things that were funded well in the budget. And now the focus is on how do we create an inclusive economic development strategy that includes the entire community. That's huge. That's huge for organizations like ours. That's huge for a lot of the organizations that have been in line asking for support and resources. And I think we're going to be doing something great together.
What is your history with CalSkate, with this neighborhood?
My history here with the old CalSkate, now the Simmons Center. I grew up in South Sacramento, off of Mack Road, went to Prairie Elementary School, went to Jackman Middle School, went to Valley High School. I lived, this was my previous home, so to say. And now I not only work here as a director and as a pastor across the street, I live in this district. I love South Sac, right? And this space was kind of that historic gathering space for all things community. You would come and gather here. You would kind of hang around here. You do a lot of other stuff here. And we're so grateful to have this again owned by the community, led and operated by the community, as that kind of creating that space that we had and my generation had as kids to now have for our kids and future generations to come, for that central gathering spots, kind of that social, economic, kind of central hub for all things community, both for skating, for basketball, for the snack bar area, and then just those fun get-togethers and things like that, as well as those jobs. This was that for my generation, and now it will be that for generations to come. My kids, I have three kids. One is 16. 14 and then 9, and they loved this space. They walked in this space and said, Dad, I want to play basketball. And they don't really play basketball. They play other sports. My daughter walked in here and got her a pair of new skates right away. And that's kind of the opinion of other kids. When they walk through these doors, they are like, wow, this is huge. Now imagine now the influx of, because of the partnerships we have with it fully just renovated and coming to life and being what it was for my generation, now for this next generation. And I told somebody, the kids right here in South Sac, the kids in these kind of overlooked communities deserve the same swag in their facilities as kids in other communities. You look in places in Elk Grove, places in Roseville and Rockland, and these facilities are magnificent that have these young folks and community gatherings. This facility and facilities like that now, because of the community economic development, inclusive economic development, should have that same swag and same coolness to it. From the second a kid walks through the door, they says, this us? This is for us? Yes, this is for you.
Timeline, I know last time when we were here and talking, you know, when is it already open? Select dates? Is it going to be fully open? What's your plan?
Right, timeline. We're still working through some timelines based on some of the next phases of our renovations and, you know, kind of the paint, the carpet, the next things like that. And so we're a few months away from being open to the public, a few months away from having that kind of grand opening that says, come in everybody. But when we do, you will know it. And we want the whole community to be a part of it for days to come. We want our news media to definitely be a part of the whole grand opening piece when we do.